Welcome back, everybody. This is part C. C is a letter, part 2-C, I guess we should call it, of the interview with Sean Robinson from Panasonic talking about the GH5. If you've missed parts 1 or parts 2, A and B, then go somewhere else to find them because you want to see those first. But if you've just come here because this is the question you want answered, then that's perfectly fine. We'll get to that question starting now. So now we're into the general category of questions, a.k.a. I had absolutely no idea where else to put this. And this might be the question that you wanted to know the answer to. So the first one that comes up is pretty straightforward. What camera / lens bundles will be offered?
So this is going to depend on the region that you live in. In the United States, we're only selling the body only.
Okay.
To start with. I know that there's a lot of comments about that one. Reality is, in the United States, people typically in this price point don't buy kits. So you'll see them maybe introduced a little bit later on.
I mean, in the regions where there are kits, is there a significant price break to buying the bundle versus buying the two parts separately?
There can be in some regions, not in all regions, because you also look at, you know, the cost of components coming in and things like that. Reality is, for the U.S. market at least, it's only in the body only. Other regions across the world, and you'll have to check with your local retailer on that one. There's a 12 to 60 kit, which is with the new Leica lens. It's a 12 to 35 kit, which is the, So that is a kit available in other countries, not in the United States right now. Another kit availability is with the 12 to 35 2.8. There's also, I think, a 14 to 140 kit and a 12 to 60 non-Leica kit available. And a lot of that's just based on region. Some regions will carry them, some regions won't.
But sales in the U.S. tend to dictate people like to buy them on their own, and so.
Typically, yeah. If down the line, you know, you'll see maybe a kit will come out down the line, but I wouldn't hold out for anything like that.
Well, I would imagine some dealers.
There's no guarantee.
Are dealers free to build their own kits? Obviously, they'll come in separate boxes, cellophane together, but.
Dealers can build their own kits. I mean, we don't really ever say that they can or can't.
Right.
If a dealer wants to, of course they're going to. But it's not going to be a single packaged kit from Panasonic.
Right. So. And typically what I've seen, dealer kits are maybe you're paying the same price for the body and lenses if you bought them separately, but they're going to give you a memory card and a cleaning kit and a case and a strap and all the stuff that you probably, you know, may or may not actually need. But it does... It does encourage you to buy the kit because you can get a little bit more for free. And then that guarantees them the sale of both items as opposed to, well, maybe I'll buy the lens somewhere else.
Yeah.
Up to the dealers. Okay. In the U.S. And then, of course, check on your region. All right. Next one is about LANC controllers. Can zoom, focus, et cetera, be controlled through a LANC controller from a Panasonic or from a third party?
So we don't make any controllers for that setup. About the best I can tell you is that the operation is going to be the same as it is on the GH4 with the GH5. So if you couldn't do it on the GH4, you're not going to be able to do it on the GH5.
And I don't even know what you could or couldn't do on the GH4 with it, unfortunately.
I think you were only able to trigger record, start, and stop.
And focus.
Well, and focus, yeah. I believe, but...
Well, no, you can. I mean, I've got... This is... We can reach into the frame here. Almost there. My LUMIX... This is made by Panasonic. This is a controller to focus, which I have now neglected to plug into that camera.
So yeah, our remote will let you focus and start, stop recording. I don't know of any third parties that'll let you do zoom control. I know ours doesn't.
Yeah.
And
to do zoom control, you'd have to have a motorized lens anyway, of which there
aren't
that many.
Exactly. Yeah, you'd have to have one of our X series lenses that had powered zooming.
Right. Yeah. Okay. All right. Next general question. I've heard the GX8 and possibly others have had the Starlight focusing feature, which they do. How well does that work, and is that in the GH5? Can the GH5 do as well as a DSLR for night sky photography? So that's kind of two questions in there. So start with the Starlight focusing. That's got to be in there.
Oh, yeah. So everything from even our FZ80 that we just released, one of our brand new, like little, like $349, you know, $349 point and shoot, they all have that system in it. Any system that uses our focusing system will have what we call Starlight AF.
Okay.
And
can you just explain what that? I had to look it up because I never heard of it. What is Starlight AF?
So Starlight AF is when if you're using AF and you half press the shutter and you're focusing on a starry sky, it won't be able to just pick a point out of that. Because of pinpoint of focus, you could very easily trick a system into focusing on the bokeh that it makes, not on the actual point. So what Starlight AF does is it ignores that and then just focuses to infinity and then allows it to recognize, like, okay, do you have, like, are there stars, pinpoints of light? Focus on the pinpoint of light when it's at its, like, most fine-tuned point.
Okay.
That's basically what Starlight AF is.
Okay, and just so people know, too, you might think, well, obviously, stars are really far away, just set the camera, the lens to infinity, but that is often beyond your focus point. You actually need to pull back a little bit, so...
Yes. Yeah. Do not focus to infinity if you're doing stuff like that. If you focus to infinity, you're focusing beyond what the optical focusing range is on a lens.
And why is that even in there? Is that for flex, like temperature flex, temperature differences? Why would you be able to focus a camera past infinity where essentially nothing's going to be in focus?
Really not sure. I think
that's always been that way.
Even on regular SLRs, you always had that. I think it has something to do with either just the way the optics have to be designed to collect all the light accurately across, you know, to the rear nodal point. And I could be completely speaking out of my butt on this. And I apologize if there are optical engineers that watch this. If you are there, please correct me because I would like to learn as well. There's a number of things I know that do come into play as to why you can focus past infinity. When I used to shoot infrared film, it changes the focus scale. So actually what's infinity in visible light is different than infinity in infrared light.
Oh, that's interesting.
So you had to be cognizant of that when you're focusing. And that's why on old lenses, a little bit of a throwback, old lenses, if you look, they had a red number and then they had a regular white printed number.
Okay.
The red number was your infrared focusing scale.
Huh. Yeah. Something every day. A little bit of history. Okay. So the second part of the question is, how well does a GH5 do for night sky photography, as well as a DSLR, you know, meaning a Canon Nikon type camera?
So honestly, if you're looking right out of the box in a camera, I'd say we're on par, if not actually going to provide you a better experience shooting night sky photography. When you're using a DSLR, you're stuck using, at least till recently, you're stuck using an optical viewfinder, which is really dim, really dark, can't see much through it, and you're kind of hoping that you're in focus. When live view came around on typical DSLRs, you don't have focus peakings. You don't really know if those pinpoints of light are actually in focus. So you're stuck working on, you know, guesstimating that you're actually out at the right focal point, or you're breaking out a calculator and working on the actual hyperfocal distances of a lens. It's just a lot of work.
Okay.
I think with what mirrorless in general brings to that crowd of photographers, and the fact that our lenses are lighter, brighter, and less expensive than than typical DSLR lenses, I think that whole collective means that we're just as good, if not better, than most DSLRs for shooting astrophotography. Now, if you go into converting a camera, that's completely different. If you convert a camera for astrophotography, I think we're right up there with everybody else.
Okay. I have nothing to add to that. I don't do astrophotography at all, so I don't know what does or doesn't work. But if you don't like that answer, put something in the comments, and we'll try and get you a better one.
for a good example, if anybody takes a look at Ben Grinnell's photography,
mm-hmm.
he shoots astrophotography and Milky Way stuff with the GX8 all the time.
Oh, nice.
And loves it. So
okay. Excellent. Well, there you go. Look that up. All right. Next one. Can you control focus, push, and pulls with a joystick? Oh, interesting.
No. But you can change the focus point with the joystick. So you can't actually, like, push-pull your focus with it.
Yeah, I think it's coming down to that slow, that focus rack wanting to do instead of twisting the lens and being able to do that. It's an interesting idea, though.
They are.
I like that idea.
Believe me, these are the questions that you know, we bring back to the engineers, because these are there's only so much that we could always test or plan for in a closed test environment.
Of course.
when the camera and everything gets announced out to the mass public, we'll always end up getting a bunch of these things that we just never really necessarily looked at.
Right. Because
we don't have somebody that works for every aspect of photography.
Of course. Okay. I like it. Good question. Good idea.
Yeah.
I'm playing with the knob now to see if there's any, I don't know what you'd call it, if it has multiple states, or it seems like it's basically on off. It's not.
So it's
a little bit more on, a little bit more on. It's just an on off joystick.
Yeah. So it's a four way on off switch.
Yeah. Okay. So that wouldn't really, you couldn't do a speed ramped focus pull that way, even if the function was there.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. But it's still a nice idea if you could put focus into that as a way to be able to actually focus the lens instead of having to reach up the knob. If you could actually focus pull it with that and then control your speed in some other setting, like you've already got the speed settings for the focus racking.
Yeah, simply... I mean, there is a workaround if you have the camera in manual focus and you use the rear touchscreen to change your focus.
But then that gets into that it's focusing quickly if you were trying to do a slow pull. So essentially, I think it's given the ability to control focus with a joystick, focus forward, backward. That's all you need is focus forward, backward, and then choose the speed like you can for the focus. What is it called? The focus racking feature. Whatever that's called. What is it called?
The transition.
That's the one. There you go.
Yeah.
Excellent. You've been working with this more than I have. Okay.
I have.
Next up. will the GH5 break up video files in the 4 GB file limit, or will it record it all as one file?
This one just depends on the cards that you use.
Oh.
I think it's a GX85 was the first one that changed this for us. If you record with an SDHC card, you will get a 4 GB file limitation.
Okay.
You record with SDXC cards, you will get a single continuous file. The difference is FAT32 file formatting versus XFAT formatting.
Okay. Which was which again? Tell I'm going to bring this
up. So SDXC records an XFAT on the memory cards. SDHC is FAT32. FAT32 has a 4 GB file limit when you write to it. XFAT has, I think it's like 128 or... maybe no limit. I'm not 100% sure on that, but you can record a continuous file in a GH5 in an SDXC card without any in a single file.
Okay.
So, like, I have two cards that I run in my camera. I have a one of our Panasonic cards, and then I have a Lexar card here.
Okay.
They're both SDXC cards, so I get one single continuous file.
Nice. I need some of those XC cards, all minor HC. I'm feeling behind the times. Okay. Good question. Next one. The GH5 doesn't have a low-pass filter. Can you talk about how this affects moire?
Yes, I can.
Excellent.
So moire is, for those that don't know, when you take a low-pass filter out, the purpose of a low-pass filter is to fuzz an image very slightly to remove the artifact, which is called moire, which is a rainbowing pattern on any very tightly packed repeating pattern in an image. So think like a really tight-knit brick wall or a wedding veil or dress, something like that. Those typically you'll see moire in. The GH5, like the GX85 and the G85, its two little brothers, we remove the low-pass filter and we up the resolution in this case to 20 megapixel. So how we handle moire is through the way the sensor works, the readout speed, the processing power in the camera with the Venus Engine 10 eliminates pretty much any incident of moire. At least in the 2 months I've been shooting with the camera, I have never gotten the thing to produce moire.
Okay.
In the GX85 and the GX850, I've never seen GX85 and the G85, I've never seen incidents of moire at all either. So you get the added benefit of sharpness, micro contrast, better color, things like that, and you don't really have any kind of moire downside. So.
Well, in that case, get that low-pass filter off my camera. Okay.
Yep.
Great. Next one. This is one that we addressed earlier. So can the GH5 get continuous power through the USB-C port instead of using the battery dummy connected to the battery slot? So the answer is no. We answered that before. So if you want to know where that is, scroll down on this page and we'll put the timestamp of where that question was answered with this one.
Yep.
Next up, can you see exposure values on display while changing the ISO on the GH5? On the GH4, you cannot do this today, both in video and in photo mode. So.
Yes. So while you're shooting video, while you're actually recording, if you change your ISO, you do get the exposure meter, which tells you how far over or under you are exposing. If you shoot, you're the one that has the camera attached.
Well, yeah. So I'm looking at it right now, and while recording, you have to be recording.
So the question for actually for Maria is while you're recording. While you're recording, yes. When you go into, or actually even outside of it, when you go into ISO, you get an exposure meter right above the ISO slider on the bottom that tells you, you know, how far over or under you are.
Yep, here we are. Okay, good. I'm going to pull this up now that I've got the setup. So, where is it? There we go. Okay, so normally, so I'm in manual mode right now. If I change my shutter speed, you can see the over-under dial there. It's showing plus a third of a stop over, down, minus three stops over, and so on. If I do the same thing with aperture, you get that same thing happening in there. Tap the ISO button, and now you get that same display. On the GH4, you did not have that there. So that is awesome. So now you can see your over-under while adjusting the ISO. Fan-bloody-tastic. Yep. That's great. That has affected me as well, so I'm very glad to see that on there. Now I got to reset my camera so it's not totally overexposed.
Yeah.
Killer.
And something to note, too. So if you're shooting and you're trying to be as super quiet as you can, the joystick on the back can be used to toggle through this as well, which will have a very, very soft soft touch to it.
That's a really interesting point. That's right, because these cameras are dead quiet. Put an electronic shutter mode, it makes no noise whatsoever. But if you're shooting wide open, then your aperture doesn't even close. So there is literally zero noise coming from the camera. But if you start rotating dials, then there will be a little bit of a clickety-click.
Yeah.
So if you can control that from the soft buttons and not have any noise, oh, that is cool. Yeah. Nice.
And the GH5 does have a noise-canceling mic built into the array for the internal microphones, but if you're not using them, you could still pick up some.
And Right. I wasn't even thinking of that situation. I'm thinking more the environment you're in, you want to be quiet. You're doing a wedding, and you watch any press release or any anything at the White House, and someone's talking, and it's all these cameras firing off. Occasionally, they show up in my news feed, and you got to hit play. And it's like machine gun fire, and you can't hear what anybody's saying.
Yeah.
But I don't understand why all these people aren't forced to use electronic shutter cameras these days. I mean, honestly, let's actually be able to hear what's going on.
I just have to go down there and just tell them what for, don't I?
There you go. You got to go down and do some salesman. Come on. Sell this stuff. Okay. So answer is yes. You can see the exposure values display. Very, very nice. What is the recommended SD card for the best recording for the demands of 422 10-bit and 60p?
So basically any of the existing top-level UHS 2 U3 cards are going to be more than enough for any of the existing record functions that the GH5 has to date.
Okay.
So that's, I think Lexar calls them the 1000 or 2000X cards. SanDisk, it's UHS 2, U3, and then their numbering on it.
Sure, I'm glad everybody has a consistent system for this.
Well, and that's actually the kind of annoying thing with it, is the SD Association actually does have a set of standards for this. It's a matter of what the manufacturer wants to show as their ratings, and that's why the V system was created for memory cards. Eventually, you'll want to look for a V60 or a V90 card, and those are your guaranteed minimum write speeds.
Got it.
For video, so.
There you go.
Any top-end card you can buy right now will be fine for it.
Okay. And then, future-proofing, obviously, we don't necessarily know, because as we discussed earlier, we don't necessarily know what all those final data paths, data rates will be.
Well, so what I can say is for the 400 megabit all-intra update, you're going to need to use a V90 card or a V60 card, but I don't think you're going to see many V90 card or V60 cards. You're only going to see V90.
Okay. So there you go. V90. Super. What is the release date for the Leica 8 to 18 f2.8 to 4?
Hasn't been released yet.
Hasn't been released yet. There you go. There's your answer. That sounds
you guys will find out soon enough.
Can I get one? That sounds nice. I like that. 16 to 30. Cool. Yeah.
I haven't even seen one yet, man. Yeah,
well, there you go. Can't have them all. Okay. Can the GH5 shoot video to one card and stills to another?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Cool.
So yeah. So the dual SD card implementation is just like you'd kind of expect in any camera that's got two cards. Stills can be recorded to one card, video to the other. The card allows you to do backup recording, so you can have dual. Hey, there you go. Perfect. Record method, relay record, and yeah, as you see it there, backup record or allocation recording.
That's
allocation's actually kind of cool.
Oh, I love that. Yeah. Oh, and wow, you can set. Ooh, you can really separate it. I only have one card in here, so I can't set it to the second card. But JPEG and RAW, 4K, 6K, 45 photo, and video to separate ones. That is really, really fantastic, actually, because that's something that I ran into on my trip to Oaxaca. I was shooting a ton of video because I'm shooting video for the group for future marketing purposes, but I'm also shooting a lot of stills, and sometimes with the same camera. And I go to import into Lightroom and have to separate them out. I only want to import the stills into here. I want to import the video into Final Cut. It's a bit of a pain. And this is a beautiful solution to that. That's really cool. I like it. Good. Thank you for adding that in there.
It's good stuff.
Yeah, that really is. Okay. With the increase in the sensor readout, how close is the GH5 to being able to offer global shutter? So you're going to have to first explain what global shutter is.
Okay. So global shutter is when every single pixel on the sensor's face offloads to the capacitor and then dumps simultaneously to the memory. Do you want a sarcastic answer or do you want a regular answer?
Have another drink. Give us the sarcastic one.
So I'd say if you're ever used to using the GH4, you know that the rolling shutter effect on the GH4 was only bested by an Ari, $70,000 camera.
I got two.
Yeah, that's all. And that's because the readout of the sensor is so fast. And that one, I think, was like 22 milliseconds was the readout speed on the GH4. We're down to 15 millisecond on the GH5. So, you know, you're talking really close to what you would effectively want to get from global shutter without the downsides that a global shutter brings.
And what would those be?
What's that?
What would those be, the downsides?
So global shutter brings really kind of two major downsides in the current existing state of global shutter. Because you have to pack the backside of the sensor with a lot more electronics, you cut out your dynamic range and you cut out your high ISO capabilities. Because the light has to go through and be processed by that much more information, your dynamic range is cut a little bit. This is visible in one of our competition's pro camcorders. They have two versions of it, one that has global shutter, one that doesn't, and there's about a stop dynamic range difference between the two products.
Okay.
And that's like the only marked difference between them as far as when you look at dynamic range. The other thing that you lose is you lose higher ISO performance. So the higher ISO you go with all of that electronic on the back cuts on how high of an ISO you can shoot at and effectively get good solid-looking grain.
Okay.
Basic answer, GH5 is really close to global shutter, but it's also really far from global shutter because it's mechanically not there.
Right. Okay. Fair enough. I'm fearing that for balancing on a gimbal like the Mobi, that the HDMI adapter will force the camera too far away from the center of gravity to balance easily or properly. Comment?
So in a case like this, if you are working where you want to use the HDMI, the adapter piece that we have for it. One, I should say it's not necessary. You don't have to use it for HDMI. And if you have something like what I see you have in your hand, which is a right angle adapter for HDMI, I don't see why you're going to have any difference in performance than what you guys have already been dealing with the micro HDMI, because the depth of that adapter is still very similar to what you've got on the micro. there's not that much of a difference, just the added benefit that you have a much more solid connector because you've got that full size.
Yeah, micro, let's see, do I have one here? Yeah, I do. Let me pull this up. It's not that big of a difference.
Yeah, I mean, there, you know, in the real world, yes, there are some differences between the two, but honestly, for what the Mobi can handle and what drones can handle, you're really not going to look at much of a difference in weight or positioning of an HDMI cable. HDMI cables, if you buy the really good 4K HDMI cables or the Redmire enabled cables, they're thin, so they don't have that issue where, like, if you're trying to wrap it or bend it or keep it in a certain area, they're really not going to get in your way for it.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Fair enough. Alrighty. The FZ2500 has built-in neutral density filters. Is that in the GH5 as well? And if not, why not?
It's not, because in the FZ2500, the ND filters are actual glass filters that drop in and out of the optical path.
That's a pretty good reason.
GH5 doesn't have any space or...
Well, it's not built in. It'd have to be built in the lens, the FZ2500. So. Yeah. FZ2500 is an all-in-one, so... I didn't know there was a physical thing in there. I always wondered how that happened. So it's an actual physical chunk of glass that drops in. Super.
Yep.
There you go. Easy answer. What is the EVF lag?
I don't have an actual measurement of like what the millisecond lag is on the EVF. What I can say is that it refreshes at 60 frames per second. And I know some other manufacturers are pushing, you know, 100, 120 frames per second, but, you run into some issues when you go to a higher frame rate, especially if you guys are looking at it from a video perspective or a cinematic perspective. If your EVF refreshes at 120 frames per second, you're not really viewing what the camera's capturing. You're viewing faster than what the frame rate is that you're capturing. Mm-hmm. So motion when you pan at 24 frames per second will actually look really solid and stable when you're looking through the viewfinder, but then when you look at the footage, it'll be all kind of lagged out. The actual millisecond lag, I don't know, but it refreshes it either 30 or 60 frames per second, depending on what you set the camera to in the back.
Okay. Easy enough. I think this is mine, too. Is the diopter harder to accidentally change and the eye cup harder to remove? This is my question.
Yes.
Because yes. Yes. Excellent. I haven't even looked at that. Okay. Here, let's let me get this unplugged here. We'll turn this around and show off what we're talking about. So on the GH4, you had the diopter here, and it was way too easy to bump that and change that. And I have lost, well, now, of course, I can't get this one off. I probably super glued it on, but I've lost way too many of these. So this, it's physically a lot more difficult to spin. It does appear to be a bit more recessed, a little bit harder to get to. And while I couldn't get the other eye cup off, so I'm not going to try and get this one off. So, okay, well, good. So it is harder to lose.
Yeah.
It's going to fuck me crap out of me. I lost so many of those stupid things. What is the ETA on the firmware update for the dual IS on the current lenses? Now, we've already talked about that we aren't going to have that. For anybody who skipped ahead to this point, because this is where the question is listed, can you just recap that real quick for us?
Yeah. So given information that's kind of surfaced since the initial conversations that we had and even CES and the initial talk, it had been under the original understanding that the original lenses will be able to be updated for dual IS-2. Unfortunately, due to hardware limitations in the original lenses with the actual IS system in there, so the motor that controls the IS, the precision isn't there to guarantee dual IS-2 compatibility, which is 5-stop stabilization out into telephoto. Your focusing speed, things like that, they will still be up to what the new variants of the lenses will do. So you're not losing anything on focusing speed. You're not losing anything in that regard. The new lenses are just what add the additional, fine-tuned controlling for dual IS-2.
So is there still a firmware update coming? Was there something else in that, or is that no longer necessary?
No, so with those lenses, there's not going to be anything necessary with it. We just released the dual IS-2 firmware for the 100 to 400,
right?
Which just came out. So basically, the lenses had to have been built, from what we've been informed from our engineers. We made every effort to try to get them to make sure that they were there. And under the initial information, I guess we basically were all that, yeah, it's going to happen. But
yeah.
I guess after we've gotten further and further into actually really pushing development for this stuff, it just fortunately can't do it.
No worries. Okay, and we can stop there. And if there's any more, if you want to know more, we did talk about this at a little bit more length at the very, very beginning of this interview. So that would be good to the beginning of part interview two, section A, the very beginning of that, the opening of this. Okay.
Yeah.
Next one. Any comparisons on copying images from the fastest reader available versus USB 3? So this camera has USB 3 built into it. You can plug that into your MacBook Pro 2017 model, whatever the heck it's called, and copy the images off. Any comparisons on the speed of that versus pulling out the SD card, popping it into whatever the fastest reader on the market is, and copying from there?
Yes. If you are someone who happens to own one of the new MacBooks, or you have a PC that has the most recent iteration of USB 3.1, transfer over USB. It will be light years faster than what a card reader can do. Because the USB-C terminal on here is the newer revision, so it's the second revision of it, you will see a benefit transferring through that. Given enough time, I'm sure you'll see SD card readers will get faster and faster. But if you're someone who has even a previous gen Mac that actually still kept the SD card on there, because, hey, it's a practical thing, who cares if it sticks out?
Let's not talk about
jab. but even like in PCs, USB-C, when you're in this level, whether it's on the Macs or on a PC, you're that much faster than what an in system card reader could provide you. So
So short answer is yes, if you got it, use it. It's gonna be fast. Cool.
It's going to be fast.
There's some other questions coming up about the USB 3/C port that I'm looking forward to. Okay. Next general question. If in one of the priority modes, i.e. in creative movie mode, I'm reading this right, can you assign ISO to the dial that is not used for aperture shutter without having to press the ISO button? Okay. So got it. So if you're in, basically you've got these two spinners on here. You can assign one to ISO. I'm sorry. You can assign one to aperture, one to shutter speed. You can swap those if you want. Can you assign one of those to ISO if you wanted to? I don't think so.
No.
Yeah, I don't think so. It's.
Yes. Let me take that back.
Oh, yeah, really?
So,
tell me where to go and I'll pop it up on the screen.
Yes, you can. So, once you hook that up, we'll take a look at that.
Get this thing plugged back in here. All right, so there's that. So, people are really tired of looking at my desk here, but that's okay. Is it synced up? It's synced up. Okay, go ahead. Where am I going?
Okay. So, what you have to do, there's two stages to this. You have to go to the custom wrench, go to operation, and dial set.
Dial set. There we go.
When you go in this, on the bottom, you'll see it'll say dial operation switch setup.
Oh,
this allows you to do white balance or ISO or a number of other things.
A whole bunch of things.
Yep.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah. So now that this is, I mean, this is how it's set by default. This is how it will come when it ships to you. Now, here's the kind of trick part about it. In order to utilize that, you have to go to your function button set. And you have to set one of your custom function buttons to do the dual, what the heck do we call it? I should know this. You have to set it to dual dial operation switch.
Let me go back into this. Same setting, same area.
So go back one page and go to the top where it says FN button set. And then go into record mode. And pick whatever one you want. So by default, you see FN1 is set for dual operation.
Mm-hmm.
So now while you're recording, if while you're recording, you hit on that, you hit FN1. Actually, not while you're recording. Hang on. I may have just found a bug in the way I'm... Oh, wait. No, mine's not set up that way. My camera is set up very differently than default, just because I've been actually shooting with it recently. So once you have that set up, now as you're pressing that, you see that now your assignment for those two dials has changed.
Right.
So I believe while you're recording, if you press that, while you're recording, if you press that, now that rear dial will control your, will open up your white balance or your ISO.
Or your ISO. Yep. Go back to there. There you go. Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So, yes, it is doable.
It is doable.
But you have to give up one of your function buttons for the assignment for that dual operation switch.
Okay. All right, cool. There we go. Yeah. In aperture priority mode, in creative movie mode specifically. That's, both these questions have that in creative movie mode caveat. I'm not sure how that applies here. But in aperture priority mode, in movie mode, can we now have a minimum shutter speed so we can limit it to 180 degrees or any shutter speed we want, 60th, 125th of a second?
So, yes, but I don't get why this question has that caveat of, well, if you're at 180 degree, if you're in 180 degree, it doesn't matter. You're not going to be jumping off 180 degree.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to change
letting
that.
Yeah, like, so whoever asked this question, I mean no offense by my reaction to your question. Maybe I just don't understand what it is you're fully asking, but if you have the camera set up to shoot in degrees, 180 degree is always going to be double your frame rate.
Right.
That's just how it's going to be. If you're shooting in shutter speed, there is no minimum shutter speed set for video. Because you wouldn't use it in that respect. You're not gonna want the camera to be jumping shutter speeds while you're shooting video. It's just not something that you do. If you're working in a professional environment, you don't jump between 125th and 60th of a second because you will see a visible difference in the stutter in the image.
Right.
So in a case like that, just put it on degree and work at 180 degree for it.
So I am seeing, I'm in manual exposure mode. I am in movie mode in manual, and I can't bring my shutter speed under a 30th of a second, currently set to.
Yeah, because you're probably at 30th of a second frame rate.
Yeah.
So you're probably at 100 and, you know, 1080 at 30 FPS or 1080 at, or 4K at 30 FPS.
Mm-hmm.
30th of a second would be a 360 degree shutter angle. You can't shoot any slower than that when you're recording video because frames bleed into another frame at that point.
Right. I thought this is a thing that Julio used to show off, was shooting video at slower frame rates and getting, so you effectively had fewer frames per second, but you had this shutter drag in video.
So
but I think it might've been maybe in one of these creative modes. Cause that's, how did he do that?
Yeah, so
if I've done it as well. I know there are ways to shoot slower shutter speeds than that 30th or whatever your frame rate is set to.
Yeah, let's see. I'm just changing mine out because my camera, ever since I've had to work with video a lot more than normal. I mean, I'm a stills photographer through and through.
Okay, no, I remember what it is now. No, I got it.
Yeah, you got to be in full manual shooting for it. You can't be in aperture or shutter priority.
Actually, you get out of movie mode entirely. You go into still shooting mode. So that means your camera's in one of the PASM modes. Set your shutter speed wherever you want. And then when you hit that red button to record video, it's going to record at that slower shutter speed. Let me try and
can do it in full manual video mode.
Okay.
In creative movie mode. You can do it, but you have to be in full manual. You can't be in aperture priority or shutter priority. Those two modes limit your shutter speed to the minimum shutter speed following the degrees rule.
Okay. I'm trying to play this back now. I don't think I can. I can't play it back through the camera. Oh, wait, maybe it did. It did come up. Okay, let's try this again. Back over here and
play. There you go.
There we go. Is it going to play? No, so that has dropped. I was at a 10th of a second shutter speed, and then I started recording video. It went back to normal. So,
Yeah. It's doable, but you have to be in full manual. And when you're in that, there is no minimum shutter speed setting for it.
Okay. All right. So. Yeah, I know why it's not happening for me right now, but I know that I've done this before on the other cameras. It's not something I normally do, so I'm probably just doing it wrong. We need G to answer that question. He did that all the time. Okay, next up. Can we assign to an FN button the ability to turn on or off the HDMI output of the OSD, the on-screen display elements? Thinking when using an external recorder, you might want to quickly see all the GH5 OSD stuff on the big 7-inch screen before hitting record. So that is referring to If I go back to the camera view here, let's switch back into movie mode. All the stuff that's on screen, the only reason you can see all that is because I have that turned on. Let me get the aperture open so you can actually see the image. We want an easy way to turn that on or off. Because right now, let's see, I should say right now, I should say on the GH4. Oh boy, let's see here. Where would that be? Somewhere under the HDMI.
So, short answer is no. That's not something that you can set on the camera. My understanding is that, to be quite honest, the times that you would want to change out your on-screen display just for a monitor are so minimal that just because the request hasn't come in that often, it's not something that they've put development time behind. It'd be really, I guess, interesting to have it, but the fact is most monitors at least pull up what your frame rate, your shutter speed, and your ISO are.
Sure.
So having it, I don't really see what the benefit's going to be because it's going to be on the back of the camera anyway.
Maybe you can't get to the back of the camera.
Cool idea, though. But
yeah, I mean, anything that there's that is an on-off toggle that you have to go five menus deep to find, someone's going to want to see it assignable to a custom function button. And that's fair.
Luckily, with the way the menus have changed for the GH5, the fact that if you go to the – so there's two menus now for – video. You have the manual video setting, which is, okay, what exposure mode are you in? Are you in anamorphic? Are you doing loop recording, synchro scan, things like that? Then you have kind of the more general video settings. On the fourth page, second from the bottom, is HDMI out. This is where you can jump in and change it. So you're really only, I think it's 1, 2, 3, 4 buttons total away from it. Not ideal for some people.
Sure.
I understand where the person's coming from wanting to see it further up in the top, but
yeah,
sorry.
Can't have it all. Okay. All right. Easy enough. Next one. Whew, then we're going to take a break. Let's see. Would be nice to have an option to get rid of temporal noise reduction, which causes lots of ghosting at higher ISOs.
I see this person has shot with the GH5 before. That was sarcasm.
I think they're talking about on the GH4. I should get rid of temporal noise reduction. I don't
know
what that is.
So here's the thing. I don't think the GH4 used temporal noise reduction.
Okay, maybe they're talking about a different camera.
GH5 is the first one that we're using, I think, that uses that type of noise reduction at higher ISOs. You can't turn it off. It's what produces the higher ISO capabilities of the gear. It's one of the factors that is producing higher ISO capabilities. So far, everyone that we've shown the camera to that has also worked with the camera, from, you know, total amateurs like myself that only know enough to be dangerous in practical shooting sense, all the way up to ASCs that have worked on major feature-length movies and television, have zero problems with the high ISO on the camera, up to 6400 ISO. So.
Okay. Well, in that case, there you go. There's the answer. Don't need to turn it off. All right. Yeah. Let's take a little break, and then we're going to move into, what do we got? Grip mobile app, photography, slow motion, USB. So our next section is going to be our last one. That'll be our last bunch. All right.
Cool, man.
Come back in just a moment. Thank you very much. Smoke them if you got them. Don't smoke them. That's bad for you. Don't do that.
No. Smoke is bad.
See you. Bye. Bye. Just come back. I'll be